Now, for this morning, we have with us Dr. Tom Goh for the fourth year. Some of you have seen him now, but Tom has been with us. You know, he's a UC Berkeley professor, and he was the winner of the Distinguished Teaching Award from Berkeley back in 2007. He's a member of many scholarly journal editorial boards, and he sits on the board of the Asia Society of Northern California, and also the National Committee on U.S.-China Relations. So he's going to moderate this panel this morning. Please welcome Dr. Tom Goh.
So as Paul said, this is a somewhat incestuous operation, as many of us have been together in various forums and various circumstances for several decades now. But we don't often get enough chances to interact with each other, so this is a great opportunity for us as well. We've tried to divide the labor up so that I will give more of an overall presentation, and then the other panelists will speak in more detail about particular issues. So I will give kind of an overall presentation, and then Jeff Wasserstrom of UC Irvine will focus more on globalization. And then Victor Scher of San Diego, this is a sort of a UC campus festival here, will talk about more political issues. Then after the break, Barry Naughton, also of San Diego, will focus more on economic issues. And then Christopher Toomey of the Naval Postgraduate School of Monterey will look at more defense-related topics. So we'll give you different amounts of information on all of these topics, and hopefully present a lot that will be of interest to you and things that we can talk about. So my topic is China on the road to rejuvenation. So what we're looking at here is a picture of the leadership of the Communist Party of China. And Victor will be talking more specifically about the relation between the structure of the party and the relation between the party and the state. Now this is the leadership of the Communist Party of China, some of whose members also have positions in the government. The leadership, the core of the leadership is the Standing Committee of the Political Bureau, which is shortened or abbreviated as Politburo. And this is the members of the Politburo wearing kind of leisure suits, Maoist leisure. They're not what we would call Mao outfits, but they're not wearing ties and jackets and Western tailored clothes. It's sort of a quasi combination. And where are they? They are at an exhibit at the History Museum in Tiananmen Square, enjoying, obviously you can see how much they're enjoying this. they're kind of forbidden to smile. They have to always look very serious. And this is an exhibit which has Xi Jinping, who's the General Secretary of the Communist Party, as well as the President of the People's Republic of China, the head of party, head of state, and also the Chairman of the Military Affairs Commission. So he has the three leading positions in the party, state, and military, as well as he is now the head of many small groups, the leading groups, which he has set up. And he's referred to behind his back as the chairman of everything. The COE, not the CEO. And here they are at an exhibit called The Road to Rejuvenation at the History Museum in Tiananmen Square. And this is an exhibit closely identified with Xi Jinping. He gave it his blessing and said that everybody should go see it. And so first of all, of course, he dragged his comrades on the Standing Committee of the Politburo to go see it. This was in 2011 or 2012 that he became the general secretary in 2012. So it was around 2012, I guess, that he took everybody to see this exhibit. And what the exhibit stresses is another aspect of one of the ideas or slogans associated with him is the Chinese dream or the China dream. The idea that China has, and I'll elaborate on this, that China has been humiliated and exploited by foreign imperialist powers for the past 150 or so years, and that these imperialists and superpowers have never given up their goal of constraining China and trying to restrict China's growth. But under the leadership of Xi Jinping as the core of the Communist Party of China, China is on the road to rejuvenation. It's on the road to recovering its past glory. So this exhibit, most of the exhibit, is about how China has been humiliated by foreign powers since the middle of the 19th century. And then it skips over to the Communist Party's role in leading China back on the road to rejuvenation, the realization of what he refers to as the Chinese dream, or the China dream. And the China dream has two aspects. One is China as a nation reclaiming its former glory, the road to rejuvenation of the nation. The other aspect of the China dream is the individual realizing his or her own personal dreams. And there's no contradiction between the individual realizing his or her dreams and national rejuvenation. So this is an exhibit. If you get to Beijing, it's definitely worth seeing, not so much for the parts of the exhibit as to what the subtext is about how China has been victimized and exploited, but now is on the road to rejuvenation. Now, by virtue of its size and scale, the theme of the conference of our workshop is China's place in a changing world order. And by virtue of its size and scale, China's global impact is great in all aspects of economic, political, social, cultural, and environmental life. That's on a global scale. It's quite clear that China wants to be and must be included in the formulation of rules to govern global affairs. That China wants to be a player. China wants to be at the table. Now, did I skip something? So let's look at history, and so not only that exhibit at the History Museum, but many people argue, and I frequently give a talk called "The Past is Always Present," because in China it's really critical. It's not just an academic exercise, but it's critical to have an understanding of historical forces and how in many ways they are still very present in the Chinese mind, in Chinese culture, in Chinese politics, political culture, personal relations, and so on and so forth. So this part of this idea of the road to rejuvenation is that historically, China equaled civilization. That for hundreds or thousands of years, China equaled civilization. China was the center of the world. The word, the name for itself, Zhongguo, means the middle kingdom. The China was the center. And everybody else was a barbarian. Various terms used to refer to other people as barbarians. What we would call foreign relations, in their mind, was barbarian management. Keeping the barbarians on the border under control. And often it was using barbarians to fight barbarians. That way the Chinese could just sort of sit back and let the barbarians take care of themselves. Now, over the course of Chinese history, China was at times conquered by some of these barbarians, in particular the Mongols and the Manchus. But they needed to rely on Chinese officials to govern according to Chinese principles. So to a large degree, they were Sinified or Sinicized. They came in, the Mongols came in on horseback, the Manchus came down from the northeast. But in order to govern this enormous dynasty, this enormous territory, they had to, these were not people used to governing that amount of territory. So they had to turn to the Chinese bureaucrats. And it's getting a little bit off topic, but of course the Chinese invented the civil service system. China's bureaucracy was historically a meritocracy. You entered the bureaucracy through taking a civil service exam, and then depending on how you performed, you could be promoted through that system. So when the Mongols and the Manchus came in, they relied on Chinese bureaucrats, experienced, literate, well trained, in order to actually manage the country. So China equaled civilization, the sense that everybody else comes to us to learn. But then you have the century of humiliation. And this trope is central to the way that the Chinese leadership presents its history to its own people and to the outside world. Beginning in the middle of the 19th century, China confronted a new type of barbarian. These barbarians came from Europe. and they were unlike the barbarians all around China's borders. These people subjected China to invasion, to occupation. They sliced China up into spheres of influence, often referred to as slicing the Chinese melon. And different society, different foreign imperialists occupied different parts of China as their sphere of influence. So when I was in Shanghai, I'll get back to that. Beginning after the First Opium War, 1839 to 1842, the imperialists imposed on China a set of unequal treaties. They're called, this is the Chinese term, unequal treaties, because the Chinese were had been defeated in war and they had these treaties imposed on them. They were not equal participants in the negotiation of these treaties. The treaties sliced China up into these spheres of foreign influence. The foreigners enjoyed extraterritoriality, meaning that they were on Chinese territory, but not subject to Chinese law. They had their own police, their own courts, their own administration. And after the First Opium War, six of these so-called treaty ports, cities which were ports that the foreigners wanted to live in full time, were opened up to foreign occupation, foreign business, and under the rule of extraterritoriality. Shanghai is the quintessential treaty port. And when you go, it's changed to a certain degree quite dramatically over the last few decades of the reforms. But you can still see quite clearly the legacy of the unequal treaties and extraterritoriality physically in Shanghai. Along the Bund, along the river, you have these large classical style banks and office buildings and hotels. That was referred to as the international settlement, dominated by Americans, Japanese, British. But then the further west you go, out Nanjing Road, and then out, if for people who've been to Shanghai, Huaihai Road, and so on, all of Nanjing Road has always been called Nanjing Road. Huaihai Road was known as Avenue Joffre. That's the core of what was referred to as the French Concession. And it feels very much like a mini Paris. Really struck me again this time. And so that the Europeans tried to create a European lifestyle in Shanghai and in these other treaty ports. And the legacy of that is still very palpable today. And interestingly, as China has emphasized tourism, they have there's a certain nostalgia for recreating the good old days of imperialism. Very, very strange. But people in Shanghainese now refer to the area which was the French Concession as the French Concession. Again, they refer to it and the international settlement. So they're reviving these terms because Shanghai's glory, actually is the Paris of the East, the Pearl of the Orient, was under foreign occupation. So they sort of want it both ways. So part of the treaty ports not only opened up to permanent foreign settlement by business people, but also to missionaries. So Shanghai was, a place that was a number of missionaries. There's still a number of churches, many of which have been reopened for local and foreign activities. So that this new type of barbarian occupied initially these treaty ports, then the number of treaty ports expanded, and then they began to fan out all over China. So they forced China open. And this is referred to as the century of humiliation because the Chinese were not in control of their own fate. They were humiliated. China was referred to as the sick man of Asia. So this is deeply ingrained in this mentality. Now, it also, thinking about the importance of Chinese history in the attitude towards what goes on at the present, many Chinese will still refer to a classic historical novel called The Romance of the Three Kingdoms, which was compiled in the 14th century but deals with historical events much earlier. And the first line of that historical novel is, again, something that every Chinese person learns. It's those which have long been disunited must unite. Those which have long been united must split up. So that history moves through cycles of disunity, unity. So there's this view that the century of humiliation by the European barbarians and then by the Japanese barbarians was a period of disunity. and the Chinese patriots led by the Chinese Communist Party took upon themselves the quest to throw out these barbarian imperialists, once more unite China, and regain its former standing in glory, wealth, and power, the rejuvenation of China. So there's this long historical sense of China being united, disunited, united, disunited. Beginning in the middle of the 19th century, when the Qing dynasty led by the Manchus was weak, China was easily pulled apart by these new barbarians. But since the early part of the 20th century, especially after the formation of the Communist Party, this is the way that it's taught, China has once more been on the road to unity. However, there is still some unfinished business in the minds of the leadership of China. Two of the three main aspects of this unfinished business have been resolved officially. And these are Hong Kong, Macau, and Taiwan. Hong Kong was a British colony. It was occupied after the First Opium War. In addition to the treaty ports on the mainland for foreign occupation, the British established a crown colony in Hong Kong. In 1997, Hong Kong was reclaimed. Its sovereignty was transferred from the British to the Chinese, to Beijing, without any say by the people on the part of the people of Hong Kong. In 1999, Macau, which had been a Portuguese colony since, the 15th century, was reunited, its sovereignty also transferred from Lisbon to Beijing. However, Taiwan still remains not under the political control of Beijing. In 1895, China lost a war to Japan, the Sino-Japanese War, 1894 to 1895. And as part of the settlement, Taiwan, which was a poorly integrated province, an island off the east coast of China, was ceded to Japan as a Japanese colony. Taiwan became the first colony of the newest imperial power, Japan. So from the point of view of Beijing, and after World War II, when the Japanese lost, Taiwan province was reseeded or retroceded back to China. At that time, China was the Republic of China, led by the KMT, Kuomintang Nationalist Party. But then in 1949, the Nationalist Party lost a civil war to the Communist Party, and the leadership of the KMT or Nationalists crossed the Taiwan Strait and set up their government on Taiwan, in Taiwan province, where they remain to this day. So Taiwan has never been unified or reunified. There's a contestation over the appropriate term to use with the rest of China. Taiwan has never been part of the People's Republic of China. It was part of the Qing Dynasty, the Japanese Empire, and the Republic of China, but it has never been under the control of Beijing's People's Republic of China. So China has, now, beginning with the reforms in the very end of 1978, China has made a policy of re-entering global society. One of the slogans for the opening of China in 1978 was "Enliven the domestic economy, open to the outside world." So, after the communists took over in 1949, they initially followed the Soviet Union's model. And then they had falling out, it's a very complicated story, but they had a falling out with the Soviet Union, and under the leadership of Mao Zedong decided to follow a road of self-reliance, to withdraw as much as possible from the global economy, the world capitalist system led by the United States. But with the reforms in 1978, they did a 180-degree turn and said, we want to be part of the global system. But how to do that? How do you suddenly, after closing yourself off, open to the outside world and engage with global economy, global political system, global society? How does a country, not just China, but any country, resist the forces coming from the outside? How can one manage the process of integration into the global system? How does one adapt to it or not adapt to it? And which parts do you adapt to? In which parts don't you adapt to? So the Chinese, since 1978, since the reforms began, have wrestled with these questions. But this, again, is not something new. We have to look back into the middle of the 19th century when China, the century of humiliation began, and the Chinese had a debate over the so-called Tiyong. It's abbreviated as Tiyong. Ti means essence, or now we would translate it as characteristics. Yong means technology or use. So beginning in the middle of the 19th century, some Chinese said, boy, these new barbarians have all kinds of military technology, science that is way beyond what we developed. We need to learn from them. But then other people said, well, but the problem is, I mean, using modern social science terminology, you know, that this technology is embedded in social political relations. Can we just take the technology out of the society, the culture in which it grew? And so this has been a big debate beginning in the middle of the 19th century between what we call now called Chinese characteristics and modern technology. Can you just have the technology separate from all of the other baggage that it brings with it? So this is, again, one of the things that the Chinese communists have been wrestling with, is to how can we manage our integration into the global system without being infected by what they refer to as spiritual pollution and Western values. Now there's a big campaign against Western values. Now the Japanese did successfully enter the global economy. They also were subjected to invasion by Western barbarians, but they learned the technology quite quickly, adapted it, integrated it into their own Japanese culture, their Japanese characteristics, and became the newest imperialist power, and then occupied China, which had been their teacher in all things. And then the Japanese began to claim all of Asia as their territory. That the Westerners say, you've managed your colony somewhere else, we'll be in charge of Asia. So it's especially humiliating to China, as Japan had traditionally seen China as its elder brother and the font of civilization. So the PRC has been on a twisting road in terms of its relations with the outside world. Since 1949, it has had changing relations with global society. During the Cold War, you had the great antagonism between the United States and China. You had the Korean War. Then you had the Cultural Revolution in the mid-60s and the mid-70s when China was exporting revolution and in contestation with the Soviet Union and following this path of independence and self-reliance. In 1978, the beginning of the four modernizations, opening to the outside world, which I mentioned, enlivening the economy, opening to the outside world. So the Chinese chose to open up. They say this is different from the century of humiliation when these barbarians came and forced us open. Now it's our choice to open to the outside world, and they were confident. I was a student in China in 1979. They were confident they could manage this integration into the global system, which was led by the United States. And the rest of the world welcomed China. 1970 had a great deal of enthusiasm about China finally coming to its senses and wanting to be part of the rest of the world. China, everybody once again revived these dreams from the 19th century about China being the greatest market imaginable. 1. However many billion people at that time, if they were all gonna need they were all going to need all these consumer products which the West could produce. China also, as China began to open up and welcome foreign investment, China was seen as a great place to invest because you had no labor unions, no independent labor unions, so labor was repressed. There were no environmental rules which were starting to take hold in the West. The Chinese began to produce favorable tax incentives to attract foreign investment. The Chinese also needed food and raw materials to feed their growing economy. And then China began to export cheap consumer products. So companies, Walmart has always held up as the standard of that, is they could produce cheap consumer products in China or buy them from producers in China, export them to the United States or elsewhere in the West, and make a huge amount of profit on that. China very quickly over the course of the 1980s became integrated or incorporated into global value chains. Meaning the production, we can no longer talk about an American product. I don't want to get into US presidential politics, but there is no such thing anymore really as an American product or anything. Everything is made up of parts from which are produced all around the world. And China began to occupy various stages of this production of all of these different products. And Chinese goods began to flood the markets. tremendous changes occurred in Chinese society. China began to assert itself in global affairs, especially regional. The 2008 Summer Olympics was China's coming out party. And if you can online, you can see the opening ceremony of the 2008 Olympics. It was extremely martial, very military flavored. But at the same time, it was basically, we are here, we have arrived, you need to pay attention to us. Part of the development with this process of reintegrating with the outside world has been modernizing China's military. Instead of just masses of soldiers swarming over the enemy, they began to import all kinds of advanced technology to improve their military capabilities. But this has led to conflicts with their neighbors, especially Japan, over a set of basically uninhabitable rocks, which the Chinese call Diaoyu, and the Japanese call Senkaku. And there have been conflicts with Vietnam over the South China Sea. Vietnam, not only Vietnam, but Vietnam, Malaysia, and others over some of these islands, or just a couple of weeks ago it was determined these are not islands, they're just rocks which disappear at high tide. They appear over high tide. And I think Chris will be talking in more detail about that, so I won't go into it now, because it's way too technical for me to understand. So it's best that he does it. The Chinese have also been making inroads in asserting themselves in other aspects. One policy identified with Xi Jinping is referred to as the One Belt, One Road. It's a revival of the old Silk Road across the north part of China all the way to Europe. At the same time, there's a maritime Silk Road, which also revives an old trading route from the Middle East over the ocean to coastal China. So the Chinese are asserting their economic power through investment, through infrastructure building, through all sorts of trade ties and increasing security arrangements across the North, One Belt, One Road, and through the South. The Chinese have established what they call the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, where they are making loans to all kinds, to many countries, primarily in Asia, that to a certain extent cannot get loans from the World Bank. The U.S. dominates the World Bank and has all sorts of conditionality in order to be able to receive loans. But the Chinese are saying, we don't care about your being a democracy, we're going to turn our not going to pay a great deal of attention to your political system, to corruption, to environmental issues. We want to help you modernize your infrastructure because look how great our economy has grown because of our investment in our infrastructure. Believe me, there's a lot of logic to that. And the Chinese also have established the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, another way of dealing with many of the countries, in particular the former stands. That relates to Chinese attitude towards Islamic fundamentalism and possible terrorist threats and separatism in Western China in the Xinjiang area, which no time to talk about now. But there's been pushback. So I've been emphasizing the way that the road to rejuvenation and the Chinese recovering a great deal of enthusiasm on the part of the global economy, global political system for China's reemergence. But there's increased pushback in the South China Sea, in particular Vietnam and the Philippines. And again, Chris will talk about this. In Southeast Asia, Myanmar or Burma, which had been seen as a close Chinese ally, a few years ago, the leadership just said, we're going to democratize our system. There were popular protests against Chinese construction of a dam. Chinese tourists, Chinese investors, Chinese gangsters, sex traffickers invading from Yunnan and occupying large parts of northern Myanmar. There's pushback there. In Northeast Asia, the Japanese resisting Chinese claims over these islands, as well as Chinese constant demands against the Japanese. And North Korea standing up. Now, you know, whether that's a good thing or a bad thing, North Korea asserting itself. But Kim Jong-un doesn't like to be bossed around by anybody, and that includes Beijing. And so when he keeps firing missiles, Beijing gets really, really unhappy about that. The U.S. turns to China and says, tell them to stop doing it. Chinese say, they don't listen to us. We can't tell them to do anything. Former Foreign Minister Yang Jiechi, at a meeting of ASEAN, the Association of Southeast Asian Nations in Hanoi in 2010, made a statement which I don't know if he's come to regret or not. China is a big country and other countries are small countries, and that's just a fact. I don't have to elaborate on that, but it didn't go over real well. Now, the Chinese are constantly claiming, we don't want to internationalize any of these issues. We want to deal one by one with the Philippines, with Vietnam, with Taiwan, which, of course, in their view, is not a country, with Indonesia, where they have a lot of fishing disputes, all of these, how much territory belongs to the Chinese. We don't want to internationalize them. They want to deal with each country bilaterally because China's a big country, the other countries are small countries, and that's just a fact. They can bully them. But the U.S. has been, until just yesterday, I think, when the U.S. has been supporting bilateral negotiations with the Philippines, the U.S. has basically said, no, ASEAN has to stand up as a community, but ASEAN is split. The Chinese have much more influence over countries like Laos, and where Secretary Kerry is now, and Cambodia. So ASEAN is not able to stand up. So China's posing a major threat to the United States. We advocate the idea of freedom of navigation. So the decision to deny all of China's claims to all this territory in the South China Sea is seen as a victory for the U.S. point of view, even though the U.S. says we have no interest whatsoever except peace, freedom of navigation through all of this territory. We don't want the Chinese to, anybody, to say that this is our territory and you can't come. The U.S. policy of the so-called pivot to Asia, also referred to as rebalancing, is seen by the Chinese as a threat to their ability to rejuvenate, that once again, the American imperialists have never given up their goal of constraining China and preventing China from regaining its glory. The Chinese also claim that they are never provocative. It's always somebody else's provocation. I used a term in a paper I presented a couple of months ago of principled victimization. The Chinese are always saying, there you go again, victimizing us. You've never given up your goal of keeping China weak and being able to exploit us. And it's always something. The Chinese are extremely unself-reflective in terms of, have we possibly provoked other people? No, we're not provocative. We're not claiming anybody else's territory in the South China Sea. It's always been our territory. We're not claiming any from anybody else. You have no legitimate claim. What do you want to talk about? So my worry over what's going on is that it's a game of whack-a-mole, is that the Chinese have stimulated through their growth and through what they thought was the best way to rejuvenate and to re-engage with global society, they have unleashed a whole lot of moles, a whole lot of potential enemies throughout, in particular, Southeast Asia, but also other parts of the world, and that Xi Jinping and his leadership are now busy trying to keep all these moles underground and not challenge them. But I'm quite concerned about the potential outcome of a lot of these forces which have been unleashed. So I didn't allow time for discussion, but we'll have time for discussion. Oh, we do. Here you've been scaring the hell out of me.
Tom, yeah, Tom, in fact.
You know, you're my former student. Who are you to tell me when to wrap up, you know?
And Tom, at this point, you know, we're going to entertain questions from our teachers. And Miles and myself, we have our microphone here. So if you want to raise your hand, we'll come right to you.
Anyway. And a lot of the questions will be addressed by my colleagues in their presentations. So thank you very much. And happy to take questions, comments.
If not, that's perfectly fine. Tom, and before you go on and have Jeff come up, I want to quickly introduce two board members who have joined us this morning. Dr. William Fuller is a board member and very helpful in helping us to understand the new NGO law changes in China. With his contacts, he's been sharing that information with us. And sitting next to him is Dr. Dan Chow. Some of you remember him from past years as a presenter. He is dividing his time between here, Oakland, Bellevue, and China. You know, remember he talked about the Terra Power Project, Bill Gates' signature project on nuclear energy? They won that contract, and I believe, or that arrangement they have with China, and he's been going back and forth doing it. Congratulations, Dana. I know you've been very busy. And thank you for your many years of service as the chair of the board. Thank you so much, Dan.
Excuse me, hey, Tom.
Oh, George, yeah.
Thank you for a very comprehensive overview of what's going on, but I would like to insert an update in regard to the Philippine lawsuit, the arbitration that ruled against China. The latest development is that the newly elected president has publicly said, I want to work with China. They have money. The U.S. do not have money. And they're asking for $30 million reimbursement, which was the cost of filing the lawsuit with the Court of Arbitration. So that's the latest development to put the South China Sea in slightly different light.
Well, right. Chris will be probably addressing some of that later. And also, the U.S. has given a blessing to bilateral negotiations. In the past, it emphasized almost exclusively multilateral. So it also means that there's been, the ground is shifting on that.
Well, you can say that the U.S. saw that this arbitration thing did not work the way they thought it was going to work. And so now they're blessing the bilateral, which they were not blessing before.
Yeah. No, so that's, again, I forgot how I was actually going to begin the speech, is to talk about all of the balls that are in the air. So I've given a list of all these different issues, I used the whack-a-mole metaphor or simile, but there's a whole lot of moving pieces, and you've got all of these players there. And I've tried to give you some sort of the historical, cultural way of background to that. I saw a hand over here. Yeah.
This is actually a question for all the panelists, which I'm interested in your point of view on. Part of our ongoing talk is, I wrote this out earlier, at the root of the Common Core education reforms in the United States is deeper thinking, problem solving of practical real world problems. Performance assessments for kids to apply various information and come up with their own unique position and a defendant. And away from a superficial memorizing of facts. Is this shift being seen in China as well? And what are the drivers behind China's education reforms?
Oh boy, that's, anybody want to take that? Or we could do that at the end, maybe a general discussion. You know, I mean, this.
I think that applies to all the teachers' ongoing understanding and applying it to our own students when we get back to our classrooms.
Well, I think it also depends on what grade you're teaching. I see middle school in front of me here, but I would think that this what I've laid out offers a really good opportunity for role-playing, like a model UN, is you have people representing different positions, and if they're grounded in some of the historical things I've been talking about, is to engage in negotiations bilaterally, multilaterally, and to see what sort of solutions, fresh solutions. If you've got, you know, middle school kids, they might come up with more fresh ways of looking at this. But, I don't really know how to answer that. Victor, do you want to say something? Paul, Victor, you wanted to give Victor a mic? Or?
Oh, yeah. So you're asking whether China is trying to switch to a more kind of in-depth analytical type of pedagogical approach. They've been trying. The problem is that there's one test in China at the end of high school which determines whether or not you get into college and what college you get into, the Gaokao, the National College Exam. And that's highly fact-based rote memorization test. And they've talked about reforming that, but then time and again they come back to the point that, look, that's the only thing that's kind of fair in China, is the Gaokao. Even though inherently it's very unfair, obviously, you know, if you live in the cities, you can hire tutors and so on and so forth, and then like you need lower points to get into Peking University if you're from Beijing and so on and so forth. But still, you have heard of many, many cases year after year of some poor peasant from rural Shanxi province whose children test really highly in national exam because they have memorized, you know, every single fact out there and therefore get into the best university in China. And because of these cases of seeming social mobility, they have time and again delayed any kind of reform of this college entrance system, as far as I understand. I don't know.
I'll give one very quick gloss on this. I think one of the issues, since Tom brought up the complete centrality of history within China in thinking about certain things, certain elements of that history are not open to debate in China. And that fundamentally, while I think this gives you a basis for the exercise in the United States of saying we should realize that every country, people in every country bring a particular understanding of history to any contemporary issue. But within China, one of the things that you want to encourage critical thinking about the past, it's very hard to do if newspapers cannot run competing versions of some events. So I think the media structure, the fact that the media has to speak so much with one voice, limits the possibility for the kind of back and forth. Now, in the United States, we have our own problems, both with speeches that play fast and loose with facts, but also with people just tuning in to media that confirm a certain point of view. But at least in the classroom, you can say, here's what one television station said, here's what another television station said. See, there's a bit debate about whether reparations on slavery are a good thing or not. Let's have a debate. In China, you couldn't say, here's what one newspaper said about the Great Leap Famine. Here's what another newspaper in China said about it. Let's have a debate over which has a better marshaling of the facts. With certain topics like that, you can only have still one point of view put forward in the newspapers or on the web accessible to China. And I think that is another thing that stymies moves, even if the best-willed educators in the world over there want to say we should be having more of this debate style, more of this questioning of received facts rather than just memorization.
Yeah, and I think that's one reason that I began with the Politburo Standing Committee at that exhibit, because this is the orthodoxy. You can't question it. Here's the most powerful men in China, powerful white middle-aged men. Powerful Chinese middle-aged men standing there. Han men. Isn't there one Manchu in the group? One man, yeah. Interesting, Jeff, though, the point you made about the Gaokao, too, the rote memorization. I went to the Berkeley campus yesterday. You don't hear anyone speaking English on the streets of Berkeley during the summer. It's all Chinese high school students coming to work on their English so that they can take the SAT. Not all of them, but a lot of them want to take the SAT to get into American schools and to avoid the Gaokao or the, you know, to Canada, Australia, whatever, and English, UK, English-speaking countries. So, but one of the other things is while they do that, they are also absorbing, especially in Berkeley, you know, let's face it, they're absorbing a certain amount of Western culture and Western pedagogy, and it's you ask questions. You don't just sit there and memorize and you know, like a Peking duck being stuffed with facts, which you don't analyze. They're being taught critical thinking, which is, then they go back to China. What might the impact be of that sort of an experience? They're not just here to learn. I mean, they don't just learn English.
Tom, one more question before we go to Jeff.
You're the picker.
Yeah. Hi, just a quick brief preface. I'm a high school teacher starting this fall, but I'm also wrapping up my dissertation. My dissertation is on traditional values and political support in China. And so part of my dissertation, I talk a little bit about with Xi Jinping's presidency, the kind of resurgence of some traditional values, like on the subway, seeing some of those like social values printed out. And I know that Xi Jinping has given speeches on Confucianism. And you mentioned in your talk that there's also some anti-Western values rhetoric. And I was wondering if you could speak just a little bit more to that about at what level you're seeing that, and if you find that the anti-Western values rhetoric, it's complementary or in conjunction with the resurgence of traditional values.
Yeah, well, that's maybe Jeff will address that in a little. Now I'm passing it off to Jeff. But you do, with this centralization of power, Xi Jinping trying to centralize power, the chairman of everything, there's also this new imposition of orthodoxy, of that there is one way of seeing things, my way or the highway. And under his predecessor, Hu Jintao, there was an emphasis on harmony, harmonizing relations, which is an extremely Confucian value, which goes completely against Marxism, which stresses conflict, and Maoism, which stresses the resolution of contradictions through conflict, class conflict, conflict between us and the enemy. And here you've got Hu Jintao emphasizing Confucianism, Confucian values. So I'm sure that Mao is flipping over in his sarcophagus in the center of Tiananmen Square. We completely screwed up the feng shui. So you've got that. Now, interesting. I just took the high speed rail, and the high speed rail in China is called the Harmony. It says Hexia on it. So they haven't changed the name. You don't refer to it as conflict, you know, the conflict train, or something like that. But also, you do have this crackdown in. Officially, there's a crackdown against Western values in education, that too many of the intellectuals have been poisoned by spiritual pollution from the West and are emphasizing critical thinking and the sort of values which the communists, not only the communists, but traditionally in China, there's been an orthodoxy. You learn the orthodoxy, you get ahead through the system through your ability to spit it back and to, you know, to manipulate it. So that there has been, but at the same time, you hear people say that. There's another expression I use when I talk about China, which is neiwaiyobia, which means that there's a difference between the inner and the outer. The Chinese learn what the correct line is, what the rhetoric is, and to, in public, to show that they agree with it, they accept it. But in private, there's a whole different life. And so that I think in the universities, there is a great deal of real discussion about issues, but people try to imagine what the line is that they cannot cross.